بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This is Professor Mohammed Hijazi and I'm going to talk in this lecture about the Leakey Persis disease. Our learning outcomes is to know about the epidemiology, the risk factors and the classification, which is very important in our case, the prognostic factors, the clinical picture and the guidelines for management. This disease is defined as idiopathic avascular necrosis of the proximal femoral epiphysis in children. It affects 1 out of 10,000 children, and its commonest age is between 4 and 8. It occurs bilaterally in a small percentage, 12%. Family history is significant because sometimes our patients give positive family history, the brothers. Also, we found that some of our patients with mothers suffered from repeated abortions and or their relatives had strokes and heart attacks. We found that by investigating their genetic hypercoagulable status, and we had to give them anticoagulation. Has been reported in lots of Persis disease occurring in low birth weight children and in abnormal birth presentation. It's mostly delayed bone age, 89%. It starts with disruption of the blood supply, after which osteonecrosis sets in, then revascularization by creeping substitution and starting resorption of the dead bone with introduction of new osteoblasts to start putting bone. This causes weakness, structural weakness of the osteonecrosed bone. And we found our famous collapse. Then the creeping substitution succeeds to resorb the osteonecrosed nucleus, and after this happens, we start in the remodeling phase, and this remodeling phase continues all through. That's why our remodeling is related to age. It's very important to consider the age of occurrence of this disease in the prognosis of it, because the possibility of remodeling is better in younger age. Sometimes we find that protein C and protein S deficiencies and thrombophilia, up to 75% of the affected patients have some of the coagulopathy. Repeated subclinical trauma and mechanical overload lead to bone collapse and repair. This is the multiple infarction theory. The prognosis is dependent on the age of presentation or the bone age. If less than 6 years, a presentation is most important for good prognostic result. Sphericity of the femoral head and congruency at the skeletal maturity. This is known by the Stallburg classification. And also to gain good healing, you need a good lateral support of the lateral part of the femoral head. And this very good support, which prevents the collapse of the subchondral bone, is known by the lateral pillar classification. The poor prognosis, we have the female sex. Remember that females get mature earlier. Decreased hip abduction, any loss of range of motion of the hip affects the end result. Of course, heavy patients suffer more. Longer duration from onset to completion of healing. If the process takes more time, this means that the process of healing is hampered or there are several attacks coinciding with each other. Especially in patients with genetic predisposition to coagulation problems. Stiffness and progressive loss of range of motion is very brutal in treatment and results of Percy's disease, because development of the cartilage and the acetabulum is related to motion, and loss of motion ensures bad results. Long-term studies suggest that most patients do well until the fifth or sixth decade. Approximately half of the patients develop premature osteoarthritis secondary to an aspherical femoral head. This is a self-limiting process. It can take from 2 to 5 years to resolve, and differentiated from other osteonecrosis by its ability to heal and remodel. Stages of Lickert-Fay-Percy's disease is found in Waldenström classification: the initial infarction phase, fragmentation, reossification, healing, and remodeling. Initial sclerotic epiphysis with joint widening changes for 4 to 6 months. This is before collapse. Then a linear subchondral area or fracture occurs, and then the head starts fragmentation. Why did this happen? This happened due to loss of support from the nucleus, which is being revascularized. The fragmentation in this phase is, it is time to apply the lateral pillar classification of Herring. Healing and reossification, you'll start detecting new bone, and new subchondral bone will develop. Healed or remodeling continues until maturity. The lateral pillar classification of Herring, we have a central osteonecrotic part, the lateral 25% of the femoral head, is the lateral part which supports the weight-bearing area. In group A, no loss of height. In group B, less than 50% of lateral pillar. In group B, C, intermediate between B and C. In group C, approximately more than 50% collapse of the lateral pillar. Surgical treatment may improve radiographic outcome at skeletal maturity for older patients, chronologically more than 8 years, or bone age more than 6 years, with lateral group B and BC. This means that A and C does not differ, the result does not differ if you do surgery or not. Classification of the end results. We look for the shape of the femoral head and the shape of the proximal femur. This is the Stallburg classification. In group 1 and 2, you have a rounded head, but 1, a rounded head with proximal femur normal. 2, it's a rounded head with a deformity of the femoral head, coxa breva, coxa magna, trochanteric overgrowth, coxa vara. And in group 3, this is an oval head. In group 4 and 5, you get a flattened, more than 1 centimeter lateral part of the head. In group 4, this is congruent with the acetabulum. In group 5, it's not congruent with the acetabulum. Our clinical symptoms, of course, it's insidious onset. It may be painless limp in the very young, but it's usually a painless limp, a painful limp, especially if you meet the patient early in the synovitis phase, or you meet him at collapse of the head, at the collapse of the subchondral bone. You may get intermittent hip, knee, and groin or side pain. I need to advise you about always examining the hip joint in cases of knee pain in children. It is very common that a child comes to complain of his knee and his real problem is in the hip. Then you have to verify that the rotation of the femoral head, internal and external, in 90 degree flexion of the hip is complete. If not, suspect Peirce's disease. You always find hip stiffness. You get loss of internal rotation and abduction. If you compare right-sided abduction and left-sided abduction, you always get decreased. Also, the rotation is lost. You get an antalgic limb, Trendelenburg gait head collapse later, and limb length discrepancy is little, just 1 centimeter. And you can find hip adduction contraction. Other causes of avascular necrosis, you can get sickle cell disease, hemoglobinopathies, and steroid injections, sequelae of traumatic hip dislocation, treatment of developmental dysplasia of the hip, septic arthritis, also epiphyseal dysplasia. This is very important, like multiple epiphyseal dysplasia, spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia, and mucopolysaccharidosis and hypothyroidism. You have to differentiate multiple epiphyseal dysplasia. It's bilateral. The Peirce's disease, even if bilateral, is not symmetrical. It starts in one side and then the other side. It's painful and limbing in Peirce's disease. In multiple epiphyseal dysplasia, is not. Other physes are affected in multiple epiphyseal dysplasia, while in Peirce's not. Our treatment goals are resolution of symptoms. We could do that by non-steroidals, traction, and crutches for periods of time. We need to restore our range of motion by physical therapy and sometimes by soft tissue release, sometimes by casting. Containment of the hip improves the range of motion, and bracing, proximal femoral osteotomy, and pelvic osteotomy ensure that the femoral head is well seated in the stem. If you find displacement of the femoral head, you need to put it back and maintain its range. You have the non-operative and the operative, a multitude of options. In non-operative, we have the observation alone, activity restriction, non-weight bearing, and physical therapy and range of motion exercise. In a child, the child has to move, but no need for jumping from stairs and trampolines and heavy exercise like that, and normal daily activity is allowed. The operative will have maybe femoral or pelvic osteotomy, valgus or shelf osteotomy, hip arthroscopy, hip arthrodiastasis, soft tissue release, core decompression, and stem cell injection. The non-operative treatment may be done by observation alone, activity restriction, and physical therapy. This suited for children of young age, less than 8 years, children with lateral pillar A, with no collapse of the lateral pillar, because the support to the subchondral bone is well. Activity restriction and protected weight bearing, as we said, it's limiting the activity of the child only. The techniques, you may use a cast, you may use a brace, you may use traction, you may use a pillow between the thighs. And our operative treatment, we have, of course, femoral and pelvic osteotomies. If the patient is less, more than 8 years, and especially lateral pillar B and BC, A does not need surgery, C is worse, whatever you do. Improved outcomes with surgery for lateral pillar B and BC in children more than 8 years. Poor outcome for lateral pillar C regardless of treatment. A has good prognosis regardless of treatment. The femoral osteotomy may be a varus osteotomy, fixed with a plate, removal of a medially based wedge. And we have several types of complications which could affect the femoral head, leading to deformity in the shape of coxa breva, coxa magna, coxa vara, a trochanteric overgrowth. Lateral hip subluxation occurs due to presence of a abduction flexion deformities. And we can get premature physeal arrest with decreased remodeling and shortening. This can also, if the head is not growing and not moving, it results definitely as tabular dysplasia. Labral injuries cause with exostosis, sub osteochondritis dissecans, and degenerative arthritis. Thank you.